great disturbance in the Force.
I can feel your anger.
Stretch your feelings.
Stretch out with your feelings.
Reach out with your feelings.
Use your aggressive feeling.
Feel. Don't think.
Reach out.
I did feel something.
You've taken your first step into a larger world.
Hello, and welcome to Feeling the Force, a Star Wars podcast about emotions in the Star Wars universe. I'm your host, Alex.
And I'm your other host, Sarah. And today we are wrapping up our exploration of fear.
Season one coming to an end.
It's been a long journey, but
it has.
It's been exciting.
It has.
I think we've both seen things and thought about things we haven't, or we wouldn't have otherwise.
No, absolutely. It has brought new things to light throughout, because we've just been looking at it through fear for the first season. Our year of fear is coming to a close.
Yeah, the year of fear is coming to a close. So this episode is intended to kind of to take a long view over the arc of the Skywalker saga. So what do the Skywalker saga movies overall have to teach us about fear?
So yeah, we looked at each of our individual movies, then we looked at each individual trilogy, and now we're looking at all nine films together.
You know, because sometimes, like, the movies do talk to each other, some better than others. And so I think that'll be one of the interesting things in our conversation is, do we get a same consistent message throughout? Does that change because these movies were made in three distinct periods of time? We had multiple directors. Things like that.
Yeah, no, I completely agree.
So because we're taking a long view, we're going to structure this differently than our other podcasts, in that we are going to be doing some long view character arcs, but obviously not all of our characters are in all of a trilogy, let alone all nine movies. So we're going to be focusing on those characters that we can do that with. Namely Anakin and Luke. We'll look a little bit at Rey, just because she's our other lead, to have a look at our three leads in the movies. We'll also take a look at the Jedi versus the Sith and how that changes over the Skywalker saga. And then this is kind of a really clunky way to word this, but our good versus our evil. So we have, yes, the Jedi versus the Sith throughout the whole Skywalker saga, but we also have, in the prequel trilogy, the Republic versus the Separatists. And then in the original trilogy, the Rebels versus the Empire. And then in the sequel trilogy, the Resistance versus the First Order. So we're going to take a look at those more political battles, if you will, and what that has to teach us about fear. And in that, to the best of our ability, Alex and I are going to try to refer to the Rebels in the original trilogy. And when we mean sequel trilogy, it's Resistance. To the best of our ability, we're going to try to make that distinction. But they use the terms interchangeably, so it may get a little confusing there.
Agreed. And I would also say that I'm going to be intrigued in our discussion of the use of fear by the good, and in quotation marks, or the bad.
Right.
Because I know in our prequel trilogy wrap up, we talked about that, of how what most people consider as fear, people using fear as a bad thing. And so we will view whether that is the good guys use fear and or the bad guys use fear, and who uses it better or who uses it for good or bad.
Right. So without further ado, those are our three sections. Let's take a look at fear.
All right.
You had a really good feeling about this.
Okay. So let's take a look through our longer arcs. Those would be Anakin. Anakin is in theory.
Hold on. Did you? Go ahead.
All right. Part one, we're going to take our long view of characters that are in the multiple movies and to take a look at our leads, because we spend a lot of time with our leads, we're emotionally attached to our leads, and see what they have to teach us. So that
they also have the most growth.
They do.
They can move around in growth versus non-leads. You kind of just get them tossed in, and you can see differences in them, but it's not a full arc that you can follow through.
Correct. So for this conversation, we're going to look at Anakin Skywalker. He's technically in 6 movies, being Darth Vader.
He is. He's in 6 movies, Anakin and Darth.
Okay. Some people make the clear distinction, some don't.
No, he's in all 6.
Okay, so Anakin's in 6 movies. Then we'll take a look at Luke. Luke is in 6 movies.
Luke is in 6 movies.
And then Rey, because she's our lead of the sequel trilogy.
And we're not going to look at Leia, who's in 6 movies?
We should look at Leia. She's in 6 movies.
That's what I figured.
Okay. Let's start at the beginning. Let's start with Anakin.
Okay.
To me, he doesn't address his fear. He is afraid of loss. We discussed at length in the prequel trilogy, in the individual episodes and our wrap-up episode, that Anakin is afraid of loss.
Yes.
And he doesn't address it. And I believe him not addressing it is his downfall. And to this will loop into our conversation at large of Jedi versus Sith.
Okay.
But because Anakin doesn't confront his emotions, because Anakin doesn't confront his fear, he ends up acting out of that fear. And I think that leads to his downfall and his path to the dark side, his seduction.
Okay. Yeah, I could probably see that. My question, though, for you is he wrong to feel those things? Because that's what we get, at least in the prequel trilogy. He's wrong to feel his fear. He's wrong to be afraid of loss. That's what it's constantly being told to him, is let go of what you fear to lose. And we go back to fight or flight, like, and just natural human nature. Mm-hmm. Like, you're afraid to lose what you have. That's a natural emotion. And the Jedi want him to repress it. And we don't talk about that enough.
Well,
we talk about, oh, the fear is the path to the dark side, but we don't talk about how, like, fear is a natural emotion.
Yes.
It is something that everybody feels.
Yes. And so this is, to me, one the big difference between Anakin and then Luke and Rey in the subsequent movies. Because yes, Anakin feels fear. The Jedi tell him to let go. They tell him don't feel the fear. They tell him to suppress it. They don't help him process it. They don't help him come to understand what his fear is and how he can work with it or through it and overcome it. They tell him to conceal, don't feel, and he doesn't have the opportunity.
Let it go! Let it go!
Conceal, don't feel, don't let them know.
I was waiting for that.
Let it go, let it go. Can't hold it back anymore.
But they tell him, like, you are a bad person for feeling this. Hide it. And so then you don't have any opportunity to process that. And unprocessed emotions, I don't care what the emotion is, unprocessed emotion is not healthy and can lead to some bad situations.
I would agree. This is going to be a whole jumbled up mess, listeners, just letting you know, because now I'm curious. You think Luke was able to process his fear?
Yes.
Okay, please explain, because I don't.
So one of the things that I think Luke was afraid of, and we see that in both Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, is he's afraid of falling to the dark side. He's afraid, and in some way, he's afraid of himself. But he's afraid of falling to the dark side.
Okay.
And we see him making very conscious choices in Return of the Jedi in terms of what his actions are going to be of, I could go down this path, but I'm choosing not to. I mean, there's moments in his fight with Vader on the Death Star where he pauses and he's reflecting on what he's doing.
Yes.
And so he's taking that moment to process those emotions. And so, granted, he's probably not feeling just fear in those moments, but he's reflecting on his actions and how that are either similar or different to Vader in those moments. And if he's afraid of falling to the dark side, he wants to do things that are not like Vader. And so then he chooses to throw his lightsaber aside. He chooses basically to sacrifice himself because he won't turn to the dark side.
Okay. I can see where you're coming from in that thought, yes, for that trilogy.
Yes.
Just that trilogy, though. And I'm looking big picture-wise.
It's the same thing. It's the same thing to me if we continue Luke's arc into the sequel trilogy.
Really?
Because, it's the pattern repeats itself. Because to me, Luke was afraid of what happened when Ben turned to Kylo Ren and burned down the Jedi Temple. He was afraid. Instead of confronting his fear, he ran and fled and hid.
Right. Totally, totally agree with that. My question is, though, where I'm, and I'm not trying to sound in any way dismissive or anything, but like my thought process is, what was he afraid of with Ben? And my argument is that he wasn't necessarily afraid of the dark side, or I guess turning to the dark side. I don't see it's necessarily he was afraid of turning to the dark side in the prequel or in the original trilogy. I think he's afraid of his own power. And I think that, and granted, this is totally coming from just seeing, this is putting the two trilogies together.
Yeah.
So if I had just seen the one trilogy of the original trilogy, I would completely agree with everything you said about it, of he is afraid of turning to the dark side and everything.
Mm-hmm.
But having the sequel trilogy, whether you like it or not, that's there. I view it more of he's afraid of the power.
The power of the Force, or his power?
Either.
Oh, sure.
Like, just, okay. Of just like he's afraid of power. He's afraid of what that power, what power corrupts.
Yep. Okay.
And it takes him until The Last Jedi to fully realize that it's not power that corrupts. Because to me, he's afraid in the when he goes to the cave and he fails the cave test, he's going in and he fails because he sees himself and he brings his lightsabers, he brings power. It's not about peace, serenity, it's about action. It's about fighting and using his own power. That's why, to me, when he throws down his lightsaber, that's him relinquishing his power.
Mm.
He's saying, all right, and when you say, like, he's taking time to contemplate, you're right. I think he is taking that time, but he's calming himself.
Yes.
Calming down his power. Because when you look at him, like, when Vader brings up his sister, he has rage and power. Like, he is the most powerful he is ever in that fight. Right there, when he is embracing the dark side and attacking his father.
Yes.
And cuts off Vader's hand. So that's where I get where, and then he realizes, oh, I bit into a little bit of the dark side there. I don't like that. And I'm going to give away my power because I'm afraid of that power. I'm going to try to acknowledge that fear, but I don't think he ever does, because then he looks at Ben.
Okay.
And in Ben, he sees that same power. And he looks into Ben and he goes, okay, I'm going to try to train him. But then he looks into his mind and goes, oh, I see a future that's powerful. I see a future of darkness and I'm afraid of it. I don't know if I can control this. And that's where his fear comes again. And he doesn't connect that fear. He doesn't of how to use, he doesn't come to terms with his own fear, in my opinion, and that's what leads to him running away of like and then in Last Jedi him literally saying, I've seen this power once before and it didn't scare me enough then, it scares me now. And it's he's afraid of that power, and the because again she was elusively connected to the dark side, she just went right to it, and he's like, you didn't even do a double blink. You didn't even think about it. It just offered you something and you went. So, and it wasn't until he talks with Yoda, in my opinion, of like failure. The fear of failure, like that's what held him back. His fear of that power. And you're like, your failure, they grow beyond you. That's where he, to me, I think he fully acknowledges his own fear, fully acknowledges his place and how he has to understand that, yes, there is power and he has to use it, but he has to trust others to use that power. And that's where I don't think he ever really did, because I don't even think he trusts himself to have that power and use that power. So that's my thoughts on and I apologize for the longness of it, but it is that he is afraid to use his power, and he tries to use it a little bit in the Jedi Temple, sees even more power in Ben, has that flickering moment of using his own power against Ben, and then goes, oh, whoops, I didn't want to do that, but then has already failed, because then Ben sees a lightsaber ignited, and that fails, and so then he's just like, nope, I caused this, this is my fear, my power of training Ben caused this, and so I'm now going to go become a recluse. So I would agree with you that I think processing fear is important. To jump back to Anakin, mm-hmm. Anakin never processes his fear.
Right.
Never processes it. I don't even think he processes it at the end when he turns back to the light.
No.
Because there's not a moment to do that, and that's not what George is trying to do in that moment. It's just he's back. He loves his son, and the love of his son is mm-hmm. what brings him back. But I would agree that the Jedi insist on no emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And, I've always felt this, and, everyone hates the gray Jedi, that phrase.
Oh,
the gray
yeah.
Jedi don't exist. And I'm like, I'm fine. They don't exist. I don't care. So, but because they're like, it's the Jedi's teachings are a certain way. And I just find this is going to be an off tangent a little bit, but I just find that so fascinating, because they're like, nope, you can't be a gray Jedi, because gray Jedi, for those of you who do not know, are considered to be Jedi people. It's a extended universe, extended universe pre-Disney term for good Force users that use dark side abilities. So they're not like only doing good things. They sometimes use their anger, and they use other emotions, and they use their emotions and stuff like that, and they're considered gray because they're not like evil. They're not trying to take over the world. They're trying to help people, but they do things that are not like the shades of gray argument. Have you never heard of these?
Yes, I have.
Oh, okay. You're giving me a look. So that's
sorry.
So, no. I was just verifying. So I just find that funny, because I'm like, if everyone who hates the gray Jedi think the gray Jedi don't exist, then the Jedi don't exist after the prequels, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, I...
So they're no longer the Jedi. So, fine, you don't like the gray Jedi term, but, Luke uses multiple types of... uses his emotions, and you're supposed to. And, this is why, the emotions are supposed to be used.
Mm-hmm.
This is why, I'm so excited about this podcast, because, we talk about, oh, Jedi are so emotionless, and they're calm and collected. I'm like, yeah, they should be calm, but, you are human/alien, and everything we know, alien biology is similar to, in Star Wars at least, alien biology is similar to human biology of emotions are natural.
Mm-hmm.
Anytime you suppress something, it's not going to go well for you.
Right.
So... I just find that fascinating of, we talk about, okay, so then the Jedi are gone. And if we're so angry about the gray Jedi, or the Jedi have to follow this principle in order for it to be, I'm fine calling what Rey is a Jedi, because she uses dark side quite mm-hmm. a bit. And I'm fine calling her a Jedi because she evolved the teachings. It's not one set rule, because they're all gone. She can call herself whatever she wants, in my opinion. But we're digressing. We're getting off.
You have left the stratosphere.
I have not. I'm still talking about emotions.
That's true, but it is...
I've left you behind. I apologize.
Yep. So,
jumping back, emotions should not be suppressed. I believe that is our... And fear should not be suppressed.
Correct. You need to process fear.
Does Leia process her fear?
To some degree, yes. To some degree, no. I think she processes her fears when it comes to being in the rebellion / resistance. Because I think she has fears as a general, as a leader, about the people that she puts in danger, the stakes of the situations, fears of, you know, can the rebels overcome this? And I think she processes that and acts outside of that. Where I think it she may not process as well is her interpersonal relationships.
Oh, she's terrible at those.
I don't think she processes her fears. And, thinking about specifically like Empire Strikes Back, I think she's afraid for Han to leave, but she can't say it. She can't process that she's afraid for Han to leave.
Well, she's afraid of Han, for Han to leave, and she's afraid to love him.
Well, that's a different podcast.
No, it's not.
We're talking about fear, dude.
Right. Afraid to love. She's afraid to let him in.
I just heard the love.
Oh, okay, yes. I mean, that is a different piece. We will dive into it more later, but like we talked about it, of how she was afraid to let him in.
Yes. 100%. No, we did talk about that. And so those are different fears. And no, she does not process them. And I don't think, you know, then flash forwarding to the sequel trilogy, I don't think she really processes the separation with Han. I don't think she processes... she does start to process the loss of Ben, but it is not done any justice and with any conviction, in my opinion.
She absolutely does not process the loss of Ben. I will say that now, because I would say she was on the way to processing it at the end of Last Jedi, because she literally says, "I know my son is gone."
Correct.
And then she goes back and tries to save him again in Rise of Skywalker.
Right.
Whatever. We're just not diving into that deep, but like she does not process that all the way through.
No. No. She doesn't. So, you know, it is harder to handle personal emotions, I think, especially when such love and caring is involved. And we know that Leia has suffered a lot of loss in her life, if that contributes to her fear of loving. Uh-huh. And then to, you know, the fears that she has or the inability to have processed certain emotions in the sequel trilogy surrounding Han and Ben.
Yep.
To continue on with Leia, because we talked about, I feel like we talked about it so much in the original trilogy.
Yep.
But she's one that as soon as her agency was taken away, she's afraid. And that pretty much stuck true throughout the entire time. Throughout the entire Skywalker saga, excuse me.
Well, I mean, we can relate that back to, like, that's anybody. Like, right. That's, like, we talked about that with Queen Amidala. Or, right. Like, with Padme. That was her problem, is that she was strong and independent in the first movie, less so a little bit in Attack of the Clones, and then her agency and her fear ranches up incredibly Revenge of the Sith. So, like, literally, Padme is Leia, essentially.
Like mother, like daughter.
Like mother, like daughter, of they're both, the moment their agency is removed, they're afraid, which totally makes sense.
Right.
I mean, that's how Han was as well. Han's not in a ship that he can fly. Yeah. He's afraid.
Well, and I think, again, to some extent, that's the human nature.
Right.
But they display it so clearly.
Yeah.
Amongst all of our characters. Both Padme and Leia.
Yes, no, those two, I think, are the biggest expressors of fear in, like, their agency goes, and therefore their fear ramps up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I guess a question for you.
Yeah.
So when you say you think that Leia has processed her fears of, like, the battle, what does that mean? And I know that's a really hard question, so I'm... But, like, because I remember you said that she processes the fear and moves past them. My question is, does she really process the fear in those moments? Or is she kind of just, like, acknowledging I have the fear and showing the courage that we've talked about of acknowledging she has the fear but moving past it?
Well, I think that's...
Is that the same thing? And so that's kind of what I'm trying to figure out of what you mean.
The way, especially the way that you just worded it, it's a bit of a tomato situation. We know it basically what it comes down to is Leia's afraid in some of these battles because of, you know, either her own personal safety or the position she's putting people in, but she puts the fear aside to act, or she does not act out of fear. Her actions are, you know, based on strategy or based on logic or based on a feeling or whatever it is. But it's not, she's not acting out of fear, which is what I think these movies are trying to tell us leads to the dark side, is acting out of fear. You can be afraid.
Yes.
But you need to either put that fear aside or process it to a point where you're not just knee-jerk reactioning. Reactioning is not a verb, but...
But having a knee-jerk reaction.
Right.
Okay, that makes a lot more sense. I appreciate you, because I got hung up on my own definition of processing. So, no, got it. I completely agree with you.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's how I see that.
All right, we didn't talk a ton about... I kind of derailed us from Anakin. Do we want to go back to Anakin and Vader?
A little bit. I think I want to summarize here a little bit, kind of takeaways to kind of bring it all back together.
Sure.
Doesn't mean we have to be done, but...
Oh, no, for sure.
Is one of the quotes that Yoda says in the prequel trilogy is, let go of all you fear to lose, and that fear of loss is the path to the dark side. Because taking a look at Anakin, he is afraid to lose. He was afraid to lose his mother, he was afraid to lose Padme, and that led him to the dark side. Whereas Luke is not afraid of losing anything. Luke's fears are a fear of falling to the dark side, a fear of his power, and to some degree a fear of himself within all of that. It's not a fear of loss. And I would say it's the same thing for Rey. Rey is afraid of not belonging. Rey is afraid of herself and her power. But it's not of loss, because she has nothing. And so to me, all three of our main characters, all three of these Jedi, have fear, but only one falls to the dark side trying to preserve what he has, to prevent that loss. Whereas Luke and Rey, in terms of not belonging or falling to the dark side or being afraid of themselves, there's other ways that they have to process that. And so, in sum, I think it is, like Yoda said in the prequel trilogy, where we get that additional clarification, it's the fear of loss that is the path to the dark side, not fear in and of itself.
I would agree with that statement, that the fear of loss is what leads to the dark side. I don't agree that Luke is not afraid to lose things.
What's Luke afraid to lose?
His friends. He literally turns to the... Like, so, at the... Like, he literally leaves Yoda to stop his training and goes and fails at taking on Vader because he can't let his friends die. And he again, and this is up to interpretation, but he kind of flirts with the dark side on the Death Star because he's afraid of his friends being killed. Because his sister, and when Yoda, or like Emperor Palpatine literally tells him, like, take up your weapon, I'm unarmed, take me and you can save your friends.
So then...
So he falls a little bit. Now, so now this is where the difference, though, I see with Luke and Luke and Vader, is that Luke, like, takes steps and he like flirts with that line, but then takes that time after and processes. where and that may be from having friends who have taught him how to think things through and think about the greater good than just immediate, I need this now. Because that's how Vader thought. That's how Anakin thought. And so that's where I lost my mom. I wanted my mom. I lost her. That's not good. I wanted Padme. I will not lose her. She is the only thing I have that I can call my own. He didn't really care about the Republic. As you see throughout the movies, he's just like, why are the senators messing up? Like, just somebody should tell him what to do. Like, there's no point where he's like, yep, the greater good needs to be done here. So that's my thought is that I think Luke does flirt with that line on the Death Star. And say what you may, some people agree, some people don't. But, like, I think he flirts with the dark side there. And he is able to – he only truly puts it away and does not turn when he throws down his lightsaber and chooses not to. And again, because fear is – because the dark side's a choice. It's not – As Yoda said earlier in the movie, once you go down that path, forever will it dominate your destiny. You make that choice every single day.
Mm-hmm. No, I appreciate that clarification clarification is not the right word. I appreciate that viewpoint because I totally see it and I do agree with you. I think particularly in Return of the Jedi, as Luke is fighting Vader on the Death Star, he does flirt a lot with the dark side. And I mean, the whole movie sets you up with, is Luke going to turn and to that moment? But I think it is because Luke does take the time on the Death Star to process and to feel that helps set him apart. Whereas, you know, Anakin was told, don't feel. And so if he's just trying to suppress these big emotions, that these fears that he has, that's just going to continually eat away at you until you make a catastrophic decision like pushing Mace Windu out the window and helping to instill an emperor.
Right, and he only has one person to fall back on.
Right, and that's Padme.
That's Padme, and that's the person who he fears to lose.
Right.
Where Luke has multiple people that he fears to lose, but he has multiple people to fall back on. Like, he has the rebellion as a whole to fall back on. Mm-hmm. They've built that up that he is a general in the rebellion, and they are teaching him what the right thing to do is, and to feel compassion and feel love. And granted, not this podcast piece that'll be in a later season, but, like, I honestly think a big piece is, and what pulls him back is Leia, is because Leia's constantly, like, how she has shown him her different emotions and not giving into fear and not making fear decisions. And, like, when he leaves, she literally tells him to run away. Like, when he's about to go confront Vader, he's like, nope. She's like, nope, please don't. I love you. I want you to be safe. Run away.
Yeah.
And so, like, we'll dive into that more later in later season. But, like, that to me is, I think it is Leia that pulls him back, is because he looks at it and goes, nope, I am becoming a machine. Like, my hand is literally the same, and I have people who care about me. And if I go down this path, they won't care about me because I will become what they are fighting against. So that's my thoughts on it.
Sure. But then that, like, this leaves me the question with Rey and where her place is in all of this, because you know, she has no one. We meet her in The Force Awakens and she has no one, and she does make friends, you know, slowly but surely throughout the sequel trilogy, but are the relationships that she forms enough to keep her from falling to the dark side? Because that's not the narrative I necessarily get from Rey. The narrative that I get from Rey watching the movies is, like, she is enough in and of herself. And she's all she needs. Which kind of goes in counter to if her friends help pull her back from going to the dark side.
I would say that the narrative of she is all she needs to be a Jedi, I think that is the narrative up until Rise of Skywalker.
Okay, that's an important distinction.
I think that she is all she needs to be a Jedi, but her friends are still very important.
Okay.
Because literally at the end, like, Rey says to Leia, like, what do we do now? And Leia literally says, we have everything we need right here. Mm-hmm. And the last shot is literally of all the rebellion, all the resistance, all the friends just being around, like, we will rebuild. We will be better. Mm-hmm. And she can then become the Jedi that she needs to be. She's no longer going to be looking. And to me, it's not necessarily that she... Because that's where I will say with Rey's arc, I don't think it's necessarily that, like, she doesn't need anyone. It's that she doesn't need to keep looking for somebody to teach her. And because that's where I is viewed of, like, she doesn't need to keep reaching for that father figure, for that that somebody who's going to show her everything, that she can do it on her, not necessarily on her own, but, like, she can become a Jedi on her own. And it's not because she's, or she can save the galaxy, quotation marks, on her own, in that because only Jedi can do that in the Skywalker saga, which is dumb. And so I think that's where it comes from. And then I think that shifts in Rise of Skywalker to she doesn't care about her friends. Like, there's she's just afraid of everything. And so that's where I think the shift, because she cares about her friends in Force Awakens and Last Jedi a lot.
She does.
And then she just doesn't anymore. And so that's where I want to put the distinction of, I think there was something, and then it just went away. So I still agree that I don't think there is a lot with her, I find that really sad and really frustrating. But I think there is that her fear is not. I think her friends should have brought her back. If there was any flirtation with the dark side. Like, it should have been her friends that brought her back, not Ben Solo. Sorry, come at me, Raylos. I'm sorry.
No, that's true. Because, yeah, it's Finn and Poe, like, spend a lot of Rise of Skywalker with Rey and try to talk with her. But, again, she just gets in her space cadet mode and despondent. And
ignores him.
Basically.
Yeah. Literally tells Finn, you don't know me.
Yeah, and dismisses him a lot.
Yep.
Which is rude.
But so I think I think there's a larger arc, and it works up till Last Jedi. Unfortunately for me.
You mean, sorry to interrupt, but are you clarifying Last Jedi or Rise of Skywalker?
Last Jedi.
Okay,
so through Last Jedi. Okay,
thank you.
The arc works of each of their character, each of our main characters is being pulled back because of the light and because of their friends. And then in Rise of Skywalker, it destroys Rey's, that arc for Rey, gives her a different one, whether you like it or not, but it gives her a different arc. And so that is the difference there, I see.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Turning the page.
Turning the page. There we go. I like that phrase. There we go. Turning the page. Turn the page. There I go. On to section 2.
Alrighty. So section 2 here, we started this conversation because all of our leads are Jedi. But let's talk about Jedi versus the Sith and how we see fear or don't see fear in both of these camps throughout the Skywalker saga. What are your starting thoughts, Alex?
Both of them use it and both of them are not good.
Say more.
Like you look, the only time I think that fear is used well by the Jedi is Last Jedi. And that's at the very end where literally Yoda is like, you have to let go. You have to let go of your fear. Your fear can't control you. But literally that's what the Jedi have been imprinting since the beginning of fear. Get away from fear. You can't touch it. And I think that's, like, to me, that was a great wrap up to the whole Jedi and fear is because they talk about how fear is the path to the Jedi. Fear is the path to the dark side. And they hammer that. And I think, honestly, that fear of turning is the path to the dark side. Like, it's literally... And I struggle mightily with the... Like, I like, but also don't like, if this makes any sense, the... Fear is the path to the dark side. That is the message through episodes 1, 2, 4, 5, 6.
Most of our saga.
But 1, 2, 4, 5, 6. Mm-hmm. That is the message. Then episode 3 comes along, and George decides he wants to change it to fear of loss is to the dark side.
Mm-hmm.
And tries to finesse it a little. And that's where I struggle. Because to me, that's changing a lot. Because this is a whole separate podcast, so I'm trying not to tangent, but I'm like, to me, that's a reactionary of the Jedi are not good with fear. And he was trying to make them look like, oh, they're not actually about all fear, it's just fear of loss. Because people were really latching on to like, what about normal fear? Like, people have normal fear, and the Jedi want you to just not have it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I think that came from. And then it got evolved later in... which, literally, that's what Rey is afraid of, is the fear of loss all through the trilogy of the sequel trilogy. And so, again, it's latched onto, but I'm just like... And then finally, she's supposed to be finally have let go of that fear in Last Jedi and then reclaims it again in Rise of Skywalker. But that's my thing of, like, the Jedi are not good, and they are the reason, like, they're the reason that the Republic falls. Or not, well, one of the big reasons. Like, because their hubris got to, again, different emotions, but I'm like, their fear of being wrong, because that's a thing. Their fear of being wrong, their fear of losing power... They suffer from a lot of their own fear that they claim is not good.
Mm-hmm.
They literally say, like, we should tell the Senate, Windu literally says, we should tell the Senate we don't have the same power anymore. And Yoda just says, nope, don't tell that. Don't say that. That'll only make more enemies for us. And you're like, that's not cool. That's political game here. That's not Jedi game here.
Mm-hmm.
So, this is where I don't think there necessarily should be, if we're going to label things so hard of, like, they have to be certain ways, I don't necessarily think there should be Jedi or Sith. Because you need to, and I think that's where the story was going from Last Jedi, but then they changed it, but, like, you need both.
Yeah.
You need both sides. You need to have that. You can't... No human is perfect and never feels any kind of emotion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not possible. But that's the... Like, literally, the Jedi and Sith are polar opposites. Are supposed to be polar opposites. Mm-hmm. And, like, again, that's why he made them. That's why the original trilogy made them of the Jedi suppress all emotion. The Sith embrace all emotion. And you're like, neither of those are good. You have to have a combination of both. So I'm monologuing again, but that's kind of my initial thoughts is just like, they both are not great with fear. Both are not good.
I can see that. And I'm glad you brought up the Sith releasing all emotion and Jedi suppressing it, because that's something we talked about in their prequel trilogy wrap up. And now that we have the whole arc, I wanted to circle back on it.
Yeah.
And I, overall, I think it held up.
Absolutely, I think it did.
Well, no, I'm going to take a step back from that.
Okay. I'll battle you on it if you want. I think it held up, but go ahead. Tell me how not.
So, I think it held up for the Sith. The Sith are a very emotional group, but I saw a progression of the Jedi throughout the Skywalker saga of going from the prequel trilogy where they do not acknowledge fear, they suppress it, they are oblivious to it, they do not acknowledge it, to in the original trilogy, which is basically just Luke, that you learn to live with fear, you learn to process your fear. There's a little bit, there's an acknowledgement of it, whereas before it was, conceal, don't feel. And then we go to the sequel trilogy where both Luke and Rey are openly afraid. And they're afraid of themselves, they're afraid for others, but they take steps aside from those fears and examine them and act. So to me, I think it was kind of getting to what you were saying, that it was supposed to be a balance, right? To have balance in the Force, you can't suppress everything and you can't express everything. There has to be that medium. And I think from what we saw with Luke and Rey in the sequel trilogy, again, just Force Awakens and Last Jedi, we were getting there. They were more open with their emotions than any previous Jedi in the Skywalker saga. And to me, it was how, working to handle those emotions healthily.
I disagree.
All right, please disagree.
This is where our definitions of, the Jedi stopped after, this is an opinion that has been evolving since with this podcast, but the Jedi basically stopped after Order 66, in my opinion.
So you think that even though Luke took up the mantle of Jedi,
He is not what a Jedi is. He may call himself a Jedi, and that's what I like. He does not follow the Jedi teachings. He literally says in Last Jedi, "To think that if a Jedi dies, the light dies is vanity." Mm-hmm. And literally, he's not wrong. Mm-hmm. The Jedi are an ancient religion. And so I will say, because that's where I struggle to think about it, because I'm just like the way I think the Jedi should be and the way I think they were going, I don't think people would call them Jedi. Of having that balance. That's not a Jedi. A Jedi is light. Sith is dark. There's no, to me, that's not, there's not a in between there.
Okay.
So that's where I would disagree. So, mm-hmm. So that, because yeah, I don't think Luke taking, and I don't even think he takes up the mantle. He doesn't even take up the mantle to the end of Return of the Jedi. Because he literally asks Yoda, so then I am a Jedi? And Yoda says, no, you have to face your father again.
Oh, that's right. That's true.
And he goes to the dark and he flirts with the dark side there. So he's not, yeah. So you can sort of see, maybe he took up the mantle and became a Jedi Master and, he tried to start teaching the Jedi teachings, but, that's where I'm just, I would say the Jedi, as most people acknowledge them, died after Order 66.
Well, and I think that makes,
I think they should have.
I can see that.
And I think they should have, because there needs to be a balance. And I think that's because there was no balance or no appearance of balance, that's why they fell.
Well, both Luke and Kylo Ren / Ben say as much in The Last Jedi.
Yeah.
Of the Jedi need to die.
Yeah. And so technically Luke says I will not be the last Jedi. But to me that's a phrase of the Jedi revolving.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is not going to be the typical Jedi anymore. So you can still call him Jedi, but to be perfectly honest, it's similar to Christian, the religion of Christian, you can say Christian, but Christianity has evolved immensely. It is not just one thing. It is a million different things underneath the sun. And so to me, that's where I could view of the new Jedi being something under that Jedi term, but still being separate of finding that balance.
Well, I think you get the glimmer of it, because I think what they tried to do, and I know fans had speculated when we got the name Rise of Skywalker before the movie came out, was that Skywalker was basically going to be the new term for Jedi.
Right.
That was a balanced a balanced person or a balanced being.
Right. Because Jedi was so entrenched with the Republic that they are, you have to be good. There is no balance. There is no evil. It's suppress emotions.
Yep.
And therefore, yeah, like I didn't think it was going to be a Skywalker, but I thought there was going to be a new term. I totally agreed. I thought that, yeah, there's got to be a new term. And because everybody is so entrenched of thinking what the Sith and the Jedi are. And mm-hmm. I mean, even Sith, and that's, again, another great storytelling piece of, like, the Sith needed to die too. Like Kylo says, yeah. Let's kill them both.
Yeah.
They're both wrong.
Yeah.
So.
Segueing a little bit, I think one of the lines that Luke says in The Rise of Skywalker encapsulates what a Jedi should be. I think, you know, given the conversation we had about the issues of the prequel era Jedi, it's what a Jedi should be, is that confronting fear is the destiny of a Jedi. And we definitely see that in both Luke and Rey. And again, I think that's one of the reasons they don't fall to the dark side, is they confront their fears. And Anakin doesn't. He just tries to suppress that fear, again, as we talked about. And so then that's what leads him to the dark side. What I take away from that, what that quote means to me, and from what I've seen in the Skywalker saga, is that acknowledging that fear is a natural part of the living experience. It's what you do with it that defines you. And that's the whole confronting that fear. So it's what you do with it is the destiny of a Jedi. And that's what defines you. It's not, I am afraid. It's what you do with it. So both Luke and Rey either put it aside or process it to help others, to save the galaxy, to sacrifice themselves, what have you. Anakin doesn't do that. And Anakin, it's all out of self-serving purposes because of that fear of loss.
I was going to argue with you about that, but after that process, what you just said there of the, it's all out of fear, I agree with you, yeah. Because I was going to say, argue that, like, Anakin does confront his fear, he just gives into it. But then, and that's the destiny of a Jedi, because he was a Jedi. But then, like, you could honestly say, like, he never was a Jedi, because everything he did was literally out of selfishness. He wanted to become a Jedi to go back and save his mother. Mm-hmm. Like, everything he did was out of selfishness. And I just thought of that. Like, so as you were, so thank you for helping me process through that. Because, yeah, like.
And so, but yeah, then it furthers his whole fall to the dark side, because, you know, if he has these selfish desires, then,
and the fear of loss,
the fear of loss is the selfish desire.
Yes, yeah. I wanted to throw that back in there, but go ahead. Yep.
Yeah. No. That's you finished my thought for me.
Oh, sorry.
No. All good.
But yeah, I agree. Yeah, that's really interesting.
So to me, that's going to be my takeaway. I know we still have some conversation here to go, but that's been the thing that has stuck with me the most in watching all of these movies through the lens of fear, is that confronting the fear is the destiny of the Jedi, that there's no sense in trying to suppress or to hide or to mask my fears and anxieties. I need to grapple with them. I need to process them. I can use my friends like Luke and Rey to help me with them, but letting it sit and stew is not going to be good. That's my takeaway.
This is my plug for counseling, everyone.
Yay!
Counseling. Friends is counseling too. But yeah, talk to people about it.
You do. You need people in your life. So yeah, that'll be our little PSA here. You need people you can talk to in your life, whether that is a licensed professional or your friends or your family.
Talk to people. Do not bottle it up. Nothing good comes of bottling up your emotions,
no.
Especially fear, but because we're focusing on fear, but like any kind of emotions, don't bottle it up.
I was going to say, we could have the same PSA in our next year with anger.
Oh, yeah, especially with that.
I do have a couple of thoughts here on the Sith.
I would love to hear those. I was going to bring us back to, we've talked a lot about the Jedi. Yeah, we have not talked about the Sith. We need to talk about them a little bit.
We need balance.
You're right. So go ahead. I'd love to hear your thoughts on the Sith.
Throughout the Skywalker saga, I saw basically everyone's fear was a fear of loss. And it was basically a fear of losing power. There was no fear for themselves or for others. Like, you know, we see with some of our Jedi, they were fearing for themselves or for others.
Oh, sorry. You're speaking specifically Sith. Completely agree. Okay. Sorry. Yep.
The fear that we see in the Sith is mainly the fear of losing power.
Yes. I agree. And that's where it gets tough, because yeah. I don't know if I would say that's the case with Vader.
Okay.
But because I don't know if he's necessarily afraid of losing power, I think he's afraid. Because to me, honestly, I think his fear is not necessarily. So I might twist myself back into thinking that it's about power, but like. To me, Vader's fear that, because he doesn't show it very much in the original trilogy. Vader does not show fear.
Mm-hmm.
But like, just, I guess this is just armchair thinking of like what's his fear and stuff like that. To me, it's like making it the fear that it wasn't worth it. And the fear, so it's not necessarily that he's afraid of losing power, but of just like, I lost Padme. Like, he's got, so because like, I think he's, I lost Padme, so I therefore have to keep going, because, and so it's so no, I think I'm talking myself back into it as power, because he's just like, if I don't get more power and hold on to this power and eventually defeat Palpatine, like, none of this was worth it. And I don't think he thinks it's worth it anyway, but he's just like, this is my only course of action. So no, I.
Right.
Nope. See, yep. Talk myself right back into it. So yeah. No, you're right. It's the fear of losing power. Yeah.
Because after he loses Padme, it's all he has left.
Yep. Yeah. Completely agree. Now, how do you feel about the Sith's use of manipulation with fear? Because I think that's a big thing.
Yeah, they do use fear and instill fear in others to get what they want. Is that what you mean?
I mean, yes, but more so of like, I'm saying specifically of like, yeah, Palpatine instilled fear in like the Empire and stuff like that, but I'm saying more of like, he tried to instill fear in Luke to turn him, and he tries to instill Snoke instills fear in in Kylo in order to keep him and keep him under him of you're not good enough, you're never going to be Vader, that kind of a thing. It's the manipulation of fears to keep people under them and so yes, I do agree that they use like actual fear against non-force users, but that to me is that's just terror and stuff like that. But I'm thinking more of like the fact that like Palpatine tries to use fear to turn, and Palpatine used fear to turn Anakin, and so he tries to use fear to turn Luke, and then so that kind of connection of the fear of turning, the trying to use fear to turn as the fear of loss is the path to the dark side.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I think, you know, putting on my sales pitch hat, it's the most compelling, right? You tell the story of, hey, this thing that you like or this ability, like, could go away. Or, like, there's this problem, right? So, like, the Sith are the expert sales pitch people of, like, there's this problem or this thing could go away, but I have the solution for you.
Which they never do.
No, they don't. But they set it up. I mean, that's how they set everything up. And so I think that basic formula works. You can fill in the blanks with whatever it is. For Anakin, it was, hey, you're afraid to lose Padme? I got a solution for that. Like, with Luke, it was, hey, you're afraid to, like, lose your friends, I got a solution for that. Or, like, you can fill in that blank really easily and not honestly have to know a whole lot about that person. Because Palpatine did know Anakin, because it was, you know, talked about in the prequel trilogy that he took an active interest in Anakin and they confided in each other. So he actually personally knew Anakin. He doesn't know Luke.
Not really. And he thinks he does, and that's, again, yeah, right. He thinks he knows him because he knows his father, but yeah.
Right, and I would say the same thing for Snoke. Like, Snoke probably knows Kylo Ren better than Palpatine knew Luke, but still not great.
No, I would agree with that.
And so, yeah, you can easily fill in those blanks and, like, you know, create those false scarcities and marketing. To me, it's all marketing ploys.
I giggle. I only giggle because I'm literally thinking about, like, so the Sith are terrible drug dealers.
Basically.
Like, the Sith are drug dealers. Basically. Of, like, hey, this will make you feel really good. And then you're like, yeah, that feels really good, but it totally screws up every other part of my life.
Well, I mean, okay, so basically just a regular drug dealer, right?
That's what I'm saying. You know, yeah, so they're drug dealers. Yeah. Yeah. Like, yeah, I never have thought about that. I was like, yeah, like, oh, this will make you feel good for a couple minutes, and then the rest of your life is messed up. Don't do drug, kids. We're telling you, don't do them. They're not great. They're not good. But... Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're basically, yeah, it's just, oh, we can fix this problem for you, and then they lie because they can't.
Right.
Because neither of them can.
No.
Because Palpatine's like, oh, yeah, I can fix your problem. I can save Palpatine. I can save Padme for you, and he doesn't. And then he's just like, aha, you're too far in. Again, just like a drug dealer. Like, you're addicted now. And then he tries to do that with Luke, and Luke doesn't do it he wouldn't have saved his friends anyway, because they're the rebellion. Mm-hmm. Like, that would have happened. And then Snoke thinks that, oh, I can make you stronger, but it's not through Snoke that makes him stronger, it's through Rey. Mm-hmm. And so it's, again, like, they're terrible used car salesmen.
Well, right, and because with the Sith, it's the rule of two. It's the master and apprentice. So they're going to dangle to keep you interested, but they're never going to give you that full power. Because that's what Kylo, right. You know, Snoke was like, okay, you can finally come and complete your training. And, you know, they want to make sure that hierarchy is maintained. Because, again, the master Sith doesn't want to lose that power. That's that fear of loss all over again.
Yep.
So, and I will say, this is where I struggled a little bit with, because I agree with everything we've just said, but then I'm like, well, when I was watching the sequel trilogy, I was the one that said Kylo Ren showed no fear. You were the one that was saying Kylo Ren was a fearful character. Yeah. And so then that's just leaving me questioning, like, where was this? Or, like, does this apply to Kylo Ren?
Sure. But I mean, I saw it. I felt I saw it. So I have no problem seeing that. I would be interested also, because, like, we've had this conversation. Granted, we are going to watch them again in other situations, but, like, I'd be interested watching through these movies again, which we will multiple times, and just looking to see if we can see different things. Now, like, because you mm-hmm. pointed things out that I, throughout this whole series, you've pointed things out of, like, oh, I didn't see that. Oh, well, maybe I'll see it this time that I walk through if I'm looking for it. Or, oh, because, again, we have our own blinders on. Mm-hmm. We have our own people that we connect to. So we were not going to, oh, I don't connect to Kylo Ren. All right, I'm not going to pay attention to him. Oh, I don't connect to Rey. I'm not going to pay attention to him as much. Like, I'm still going to pay attention, but I'm like, okay, it's just angry. They're just an angry person. Like, I don't connect with Obi-Wan, so I don't really see the finesse of his character, that kind of thing. Like, mm-hmm. So I'll be very interested to rewatch these. Granted, we'll watch them through different lenses, but, like, to just watch them again and say, hey, yeah. do we see the fear in different ways that we, because you've brought things up and that our conversations have completely changed how I viewed the trilogy and the sequels and the whole nine.
Yeah.
In general, so.
Yeah.
But I think that's a good segue into our part three.
Yeah, our final section.
Final section.
The other good versus evil conversation.
Yes. This is where we can actually talk about, like, fear of different sections, but...
Yes. So again, listeners, we're going to do our best when we say Rebels. We're talking about original trilogy. And when we say Resistance, we're talking about sequel trilogy. We're going to try our best. Well, we started in with the Jedi the last time and spent a lot of time on that. So how about we flip the script this time?
Okay.
And so let's start talking about our quote-unquote evil regimes, our Separatists, the Empire, and the First Order.
Okay. Who do we want to start with?
Let's go in numerical order. So the Separatists in the prequel trilogy, you know, chronological order in universe.
Okay. I'm going to say this is going to be hard for me,
yep,
especially with the Separatists, yep, because of it's going to be hard just looking at them in the trilogy itself.
Okay.
Knowing things behind the scenes or like just expanded universe of current Disney, but just of that kind of knowing, sure, other things, because it basically evolves to not necessarily that they're the good guys at the end, but like they're not using the fear very much at the end. They're afraid, but at the beginning they're the ones instilling fear. They blockade the Naboo, and they try to instill the fear and torture them and make them sign the treaty and everything. And then in the second, that's when the Clone Wars actually start, and we have Separatists and everything. And it's a fear. They're trying to instill fear in the Republic because they're trying to separate and fight and combat the Republic. Because that's one thing that I've never fully understood. And again, I guess it makes sense with the Sith pulling the strings and stuff like that, but like they're literally called the Separatists. Why are they fighting the Republic?
It's the right to secede.
But they never talk about, like, the Republic never says that they're fighting to keep them in. It's like we have to defend ourselves. They create an army to defend the Republic. And it's like because the Separatists have attacked them. And I'm like, so why did the Separatists... So this is a side tangent. So I need to stop. But like, that's my thing. I'm just like, it's not... Anyway. Because you could... Anyway. Yeah, because this was not the Civil War. This was not the North and South. Right? To secede and everything. But...
Yeah.
Anyway. So yeah, but I see that there's a drastic shift in the Separatists. In the beginning, they are instilling fear everywhere they can. I think the generals and characters are attempting to become scarier as the movies go on, to instill fear in both the audience and the people around them. But they are also, I think that's a little bit hampered in Revenge of the Sith, in that like you're also supposed to look at them and see they're just blubbering idiots and being manipulated by the real bad guy, air quotes. And so they're not really instilling fear, the Separatists, I don't think, in Revenge of the Sith. What do you think?
Well, I completely agree with that back part. To me, the Separatists are afraid the whole time, even in Phantom Menace, when they are instilling fear and doing the blockade on Naboo. You can tell that they're petrified, basically. As soon as they turn off the communique with anyone associated with Naboo, they're terrified. And to me, it makes sense. For on a couple of levels. One, especially I think throughout, the Separatists are a smaller group of systems than the Republic as a whole. So they're outnumbered the whole time. And, you know, that creates fear, right? You are a smaller group taking on a larger group with a lot of resources. But they're also, to me, the Separatists are afraid, and maybe I'm just thinking the Neo-Moidians are afraid, because they have no agency in the situation. They're puppets for Palpatine. And so they're basically just being told what to do, and they don't have control over their actions. I think, so I will take that back. That's basically just the Neo-Moidians.
Yes, I would say that, yep.
But we also see that in Revenge of the Sith, too, because that whole Council of the Separatists don't do a whole lot in the movie. And they just kind of shuffle from one planet to the other, like evacuating and hiding.
Right. I will agree. I think that has to do with not knowing, like not having a I think a lot of the shift that I am seeing, that I'm seeing, I think that's happenstance. I don't think it's actually like something that George designed, because like it, if it was something that George designed, it was poor writing in the end. And I don't think that, I think it was just like, it was happenstance of like, oh, they're instilling a lot of fear in the beginning, and then now they're not, because you have to shift. And the reason they're not is because George has to shift the fear of, you're afraid of Palpatine now, not the Separatists. And so, but no, I agree. And I think,
and right. I'm interrupting.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, you see the man behind the mask.
Right.
And so it's like, you're afraid of the mask, but then you realize the person wearing the mask is 10 times more frightening than the mask itself.
And he's the good, technically been the good guy the whole time. So that's where it's like, you have to, that's where I think it's the difficult piece of like, he's been the Republic the whole time. And like, we all knew who he was, just knowing, because it's pretty obvious to start with, the voices sound the same, but it's just like the fact that he's now openly out there and everything, you're like, well, okay, how do we do this? And so I would agree with that. Yeah, the Separatists are just, I would agree that they're mostly fearful, unfortunately. Again, my struggle to separate of like, unfortunately, like the Nemoidians are basically the only Separatists we see.
That we spend any time
with. We spend any kind of time with. Like, we sort of see them show a little gumption in, like, different Separatists in the Clone War, and Attack of the Clone, in Attack of the Clones, but that goes away real quick, and then it goes back to, oh, we're all afraid again. Yeah. So yeah, we have some person behind the scenes that's instilling fear in the Separatists, and then that shifts to not. So, how do you feel about the Empire?
To me, it's an interesting similarity between the Separatists in that they start, the first movie that we see them in, they come out hard and fast as instilling fear. But as we progress through the trilogy, just like with the Separatists, we lose some of that. We lose the instilled fear that the Empire is instilling less and less fear, just as the Separatists were instilling less and less fear.
What do you mean, like, act that we actually see, or you think they are actively instilling less?
That we see.
Okay, no, I agree with that, yes. In that we see them instilling a lot of fear in the first movie, and we do not see them instilling a lot in the later
movies. In subsequent movies.
Yes, okay, I completely agree with that. That's what I wanted to verify.
Yes, and I think in part with the original trilogy in particular, it's because you're shifting, and so as you get into Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi, you see a lot more of the internal fear within the Empire, and the internal power plays that are going on. And so that, again, you're lifting that mask up that, you know, the people on the inside are just as afraid as the people on the outside. That probably
right. came. I mean
That came just out a little afraid. Wrong. That came it's, out a little wrong.
Not really. Like, but I mean, like, they're not, probably not just as afraid. I mean, no, they probably are just as afraid, but just for different reasons. Of like, because all of them are afraid of their lives.
Right, everyone is expendable.
Like, that's the scary part, is that, yeah, like, they're all afraid of their lives, except the other, on the outside, it's, we are fighting back, or we are just the people that are around, versus, like, the people inside of, like, I'm working, and I'm trying to rise up higher, and the higher I get, the more my neck gets put out on a limb.
Exactly.
That, and so you're like, but the more higher I up, I get more power, and so it's that, no, it may have sounded iffy, but I think it's very accurate of that both inside and out are afraid. And so, yeah, the question becomes, like, which one do you want to be? Do you want to be fighting for the good and still be afraid? Or do you want to just sit back and watch and be afraid too?
Right.
I mean, that sounds like a super easy choice. It's not, like, when you think about all the things that go into it of do you want to eat and stuff like that. But
right, because, I mean, either way, you're being oppressed
and
suppressed. So it's just like, which way do you go with it? And to me, and then, you know, kind of tangenting a little bit in some of our extra Star Wars that we're getting through the TV shows and the books, and they talk about, you know, like, my grandfather served in the Empire, or my father served in the Empire, and, like, because he could get us steady food. And it's like, right. Yeah, if you're going to be oppressed anyway, go with the oppression that gives you 3 square meals a day.
Yep.
versus cutting off and creating famines, which we know the Empire
does,
or destroying your world. You know, at least with the Empire, I will have somewhere to lay my head at night.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I want to shout out before anyone calls out or whatever, we are not saying it's acceptable to be fascists.
No, that is not what we're saying.
We are just looking at the whole picture and seeing, like, yeah, you have an option to starve or get food. Which are you going to pick?
Right. You can understand how people made these decisions that completely removed from the situation. You're like, how can you make that decision?
Right. But then you can also look at, but there, and I think that's us looking at more of the grunt in this, but like, mm-hmm. You look at the main people that we see, even the people that we see in Fears of, like, the generals, the admirals, all those people, like, they chose this. They are this. We're talking about the low end, like, stormtroopers, maybe, or like mechanics, that kind of stuff, where like they may had a choice of either that kind of thing. Higher ups that we also see, that we see a lot of, we see a lot more of that fear being instilled in them. They chose, let's move up and try to get more power, but they're sticking their neck out further. That's right. I think that's what we see in the movie.
Yes, and a lot of those actions are more inexcusable.
Oh, all of them are inexcusable. Yes, yes.
Yeah.
For the higher ups, yes, absolutely. Yes.
Yeah, the one quote that Grand Moff Tarkin says, that fear will keep the systems in line, to me that just, it works both externally and internally.
Oh, completely. It's how the Empire works.
Yes.
It's one of the reasons it fails.
Yes. All right. So then how does this connect to our First Order? Does it connect to our First Order?
I think it does, because I think they tried to imitate the Empire. And it's, I guess, yeah, that, because I mean, like, it's basically the Empire again. Like,
more or less.
Yeah. And I'm just like, we have to call it something else because of storytelling. But I'm just like, it's basically the Empire again.
Yeah.
So, yeah, because, like, it's, again, it's fear is instilled. I think they give even more credence to the fear in the lower levels because, like, the stormtroopers are brainwashed.
Oh, yeah.
And so it's not, like, because, like, before we knew in the Empire, like, they're recruits. You join because you believe in the Empire.
Yeah.
Versus we get told straight away, I have no memory of my family, my children. I was taken when I was a child, and all I've known is this.
Yeah.
And that's scary. Not knowing anything about except a number, not having anything, like, that's scary.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all afraid of each other. There, we get the Nuremberg screaming match from Hux and the instillation of fear of that, and like, we will instill fear in our enemies, and he's deathly afraid of Snoke all the time, and he's afraid of Kylo Ren, and everybody else is afraid of Kylo Ren to a comical degree. They use that as a joke numerous times, but yeah, it's instill fear. I think it's done worse, honestly, than the Empire's showing. Like,
really?
Like, storytelling wise.
Okay. Can you say more on that?
Not really. Okay, because, like, that's fair. Because what if I go into that, it's going to be something that's not this podcast.
Okay.
So this is just more of a criticism of the First Order itself. And I don't need to go into that. Just like, I think it was done, the fear showing. I think the fear instilled by the First Order on others was shown better than the Empire.
I would agree.
I still think, for all my feelings on Rise of Skywalker, I think the First Order, like, raiding homes on, I can't remember the name of the planet.
Oh.
But that they blow up eventually.
Kijimi,
there it is. Like, when they're raiding homes on Kijimi and stuff like that, and they've blockaded the city, and, like,
mm-hmm.
that hits hard.
It's really scary.
Yeah. And so, to me, that's the so they, to me, their installation, their instilling of fear on others is a lot better than what was done in the Empire, I think. And there's reasons for that and stuff like that, of just, like, they had more money in production now, but... Oh, yes, go ahead. And that's about it.
I have a different hypothesis.
Oh, okay.
With that. So I agree with you that the First Order has a higher level of intensity, or a maintained level of fear intensity, than we see with the Empire.
Yep.
My hypothesis is because they haven't lost.
What do you mean?
So, taking a look at the Separatists lose quite a few battles. So that kind of takes down their street cred, if you will. And so they're less scary as we progress through the trilogy.
Yep.
It's the same thing with the Empire. The Rebels blow up the Death Star in the first movie, and that's a really big blow to the Empire. So the Empire itself is weakened. And so then I think after that point, the Empire is a little less scary because their grip is loosening because they suffered such a heavy blow. I'm going to make the argument that the First Order didn't lose. Yes, Starkiller Base was blown up. But before that happened, they blew up the entire New Republic. And because they exposed, because they let the rebel, the whole New Republic was destroyed. The rebels came, or the resistance came to Starkiller Base and blew that up. The First Order was then able to track the resistance back to their base, and in the aftermath of that, nearly destroyed the entire resistance. So to me, you know, talking again, long-term war strategy, losing Starkiller Base would have been worth it if you were able to wipe out the entire resistance in that action.
I would agree. I hadn't thought of it that way, but then my cynical thought jumps to like, okay, cool, they're super rich, which is great. Like, that's a new element, I guess, that they're crazy rich and richer than the Empire, which is, I'm not knocking that. But then why is, I'll just dive in, because I'm like, why is it important in Rise of Skywalker that they get a whole bunch of more Star Destroyers? Like,
yeah.
That's the stuff. But no, I agree. I think that's an interesting thought, and I can very much see it. And I'm gonna have to think about that before I actually dive in and accept it as fact.
You don't have to accept it. Looking at our similarities and differences between these three opposing regimes, it's like, you know, yes, the First Order did lose Starkiller, but because Last Jedi happens right on the heels, and because the Resistance is so decimated by the end, to me it's almost a victory for the First Order, and that's how they can maintain that high level of intensity. That's why no one's coming to help the Resistance on Krait. It's why it takes a little while to get people to come help as they're fighting for the fate of the galaxy in Rise of Skywalker.
Right. My thought that has come to me is that they might show more and show that fear and exterior fear more is because they don't have the buy-in.
That could be true.
And that's where, because with the Empire, it was, we can make your life better, so buy into us and be recruits and stuff. But in the First Order, they're like, we're going to brainwash you, so we don't need your buy-in. And so we just are going to instill fear completely. Like, in the Empire, I feel like that, yes, they use fear. And especially when we start the trilogy of, we will use fear to keep the systems in line. I think that's the game. But because the Republic kind of just morphed into the Empire, there's more of a buy-in. There's more of, this system works. We're just shifting it around a bit. And so keeping exterior pieces, like, they kept, it's not in the movies, but like, they kept things quiet in the Empire, of like, they didn't, let's just blow up a planet. It was, hey, let's go exploit this small planet here and then shut down all news going to and from that planet so people don't know about it.
Right.
It was gradual, that kind of a thing, versus like First Order, they're like, hey, we're kind of a thing, and then bam, we're gonna blow up planets and just go everywhere. So that,
yeah, you get the sense that they, and from a little bit of what we know in the, you know, outside canon of the movies, it was a little bit of like going 0 to 60.
Yeah. And so that's kind of where I have just kind of put it together. Yeah. with the Separatists, I think there was still buy-in because the people were unhappy with the Republic.
Yeah.
And so they're like, we're unhappy, so we're going to join the Separatists and stuff like that, versus like the First Order, You don't really see good people in there. Like, you don't see, like, you never see a planet be like, yes, let's join the First Order.
And be,
like,
happy about it.
And be happy about it. It's, hey, we're taking you over. So, like, maybe that happens in, I think that happens in, like, Bloodline, the book or whatever, but, like, that's separate and, like, not a thing we're talking about, but
right.
It's that kind of thing, so. Very cool. Thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah, no, I like that other piece of it, too, that you brought up.
All right, so now to the Republic? Are we doing Republic?
It's the three R's.
The three R's, Republic, like Rebels, and Resistance.
We need a shirt with the three R's on it.
There we go.
Yeah, like reading or writing and arithmetic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, three R's.
Except that's AR.
Right, but they still say it's the three R's, reading, mm-hmm. writing, and arithmetic.
I've never heard that.
Oh, well, okay. So then let's go chronological order in universe. So the Republic.
I don't see a ton of fear there.
Oh, I disagree.
Okay.
So reading my notes, I grouped it all together. So just throw that out the window. what I have in my notes here is that the Republic and the Resistance are more fearful than the Rebellion, because they have something left to lose. The Rebels don't have anything left to lose.
I mean, I agree with that statement. Where are we seeing fear in the Republic? I'm struggling because I don't see the Republic as showing a ton. It's more of the Jedi itself, but go ahead.
So I see fear in the Republic, again, mainly in the Senate, because that's what we see of it. But in Phantom Menace, there's a lot of fear when Queen Amidala comes to make her pledge, and then because the Separatists are like, that's a lie, send it to committee, and then the vote of no confidence is called. There's a lot of fear and confusion with that. And then when we go into Attack of the Clones, that fear has continued as the Separatists are rising and stirring things again. It's mainly because people don't know what's going on and what's going to happen. Again, that fear of loss. And it makes them afraid of, like, well, are the Separatists actually going to, you know, put a wrinkle in the Republic? Are we going to lose the Republic? I mean, that's one of the big questions of the prequel trilogy and the Separatists wanting to secede is, are we going to lose the Republic? And that's a big loss, not just for the senators, who that's their job, and then they'd be unemployed if there's no Republic, but the systems, the support, the trade, the relative peace you have with all of these alliances. That's a really big loss.
I agree with everything you just said. I just struggle to see, except, like, where you saw the
fear.
Where
we see it.
The only person I see it in, and you could be totally right, is Amidala.
I mean, Amidala shows it. I see Bail showing it.
Oh, Bail. Like, okay, I guess, no, you're right.
And basically,
I think you're right. I didn't see it, and because, again, I don't think, I struggled to see the Republic as, like, individuals. That's what I'll say. Of, like, I thought it was just like, okay, the like, Bail Organa and I kind of just lumped them in with the Jedi, honestly. Well, because that's who we're mostly with.
But again, so it also shows how intertwined those two systems are. And it's
right.
To probably the detriment of both.
Detriment of both. Completely agree. Yes.
Separation of church and state.
Hey!
All right. That's a different thing. But then I also have in my notes that the Resistance is also more fearful because they have something to lose. The Resistance has more to lose because the New Republic gets destroyed kind of middle end-ish of Force Awakens. And everything is so fresh. Like, the losses are so fresh and people can remember what was before. Because this was one of the conversations we had about the Rebels of when we talked about in the original trilogy is, you know, the Empire has been going on for 20 years. There's a lot of people who don't remember what it was like before, and so there's nothing left to lose because, like, you don't have that, like, hope that it could go back to what it was. You've only known one thing.
Okay. I was gonna slightly disagree, but no, with you stating that, yeah. Because I think the rebels show fear or are fearful. Yes. But I don't think they show it as much. I think they're fearful and they're like, yeah, we could, like, I could individually die. And that's a fearing. Mm-hmm. But then I think, I agree with you of like when, but then they're like, okay, this is the end of the resistance or the rebellion, but like we can just kind of go and regroup and, because they're like, oh, we'll just go and we'll retreat and regroup and try to find more people. But like with the resistance, it's just like, this is it. There is no, and I don't know if that's a good thing or whether that's writing or whatever, but it's like we are fighting, and if we lose, the world ends. The universe ends.
Well, because that was one of the big questions I have here, because it gets to the point in the stakes with the rebels, with both the rebels and the resistance, of like, if we lose, you know, both the rebels or the resistance lose, like the Empire is just going to be under this basically fascist regime. But to me, like, the resistance is so much more afraid.
Yes, I will completely agree with that.
Than the rebellion. And why? Why do you think that is?
I think it's what you said. I think it's, I hadn't thought about it, but I think that is literally it. Because the rebellion was built bit by bit. And so as long as, like, there's always, I think that's what the rebellion always knows, is like, there's always going to be people to fight. And it's been 30 years, so we fought and we lost and everybody dies, but eventually people will fight again. Versus with the resistance, it's, we just lost the Republic, and if we go under a fascist regime, the world will end and people will die. And it's I think it's honestly because it's the, there's a specific word for it, but like the desensitization of, in the rebels, of like, people are dying all the time. Like, we are trying to prevent that, and it's sad that they are dying all the time, but like, we are trying to prevent that, but that's not, like, we are doing our best. Versus the resistance are like, we have to prevent people from dying because we are all that's left of the Republic. And it's that kind of, if we go, it's over. And there's not, and that's why I think the resistance is not the best name for them. But it's just like, because they're just like, we are the Republic and we are trying to keep them from taking over the entire galaxy and bringing in a galaxy-wide darkness. So that's where I think you're completely right, in that it is a recency of, we have the past and we're still fighting for that, and we've been fighting that for a little while, because they're like, we got to fight the Republic, but it's been a year, a couple years at most.
Right, and that's the other part that I forget too, is the whole events of the sequel trilogy are on such a much
smaller,
more condensed timeline. Because yes, the original trilogy, what, the events between, it's a couple years more, because there's actually a couple years that pass between New Hope and Empire, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's even more time happens in the original trilogy. And you get the context in the original trilogy of, the Empire's been around a long time.
Yep.
Whereas it's established pretty early on in the sequel trilogy, as the First Order is like this new, hot, up-and-coming menace.
Well, that it's a menace, but that it's not, I mean, like, with the Republic, it's not viewed as, like, a really bad thing at first.
Yeah, they,
like,
dismiss it.
They dismiss it. And it's just like, okay, yeah, it's a thing. Like, it's their own system thing out there, but they're not going to do anything to us.
Yeah.
And it's their own thing. And you're like, it's similar to the Separatists. And they're like, they just like, yep, they're out there doing their own thing, and we'll do ours. Mm-hmm. But then they're like, nope, they're actually a big threat. And okay, they want to take over the world. Or the universe.
Thanks for helping me process through that, because yeah, as I was thinking back, I'm like, this makes no sense why the resistance is so afraid. But right, with all of this, it does.
No, yeah,
it does
make sense. I'm totally with you, so I thank you, because I'm just like, yeah, why are they so afraid? Why is it always do or die with them and everything? But because I mean, like, it's do or die with the rebels, but they're not that afraid. Like, they're afraid, but it's not just like, oh my gosh, guys, I ruined it. It's all over. Because that's literally what Poe does. Poe does. He's like, the game's over. I ruined it. Sorry. That never happens with the rebels.
No. Yeah.
So yeah, there's our wrap. There's all of our pieces.
Yeah. But yeah, that's all I have.
That's all I have.
This is an amazing conversation.
This was really good. I'm really pleased that we did this, because I will tell you, this episode happened because of Sarah.
You're welcome, listeners.
Yep, because I was just thought we would wrap it all up in our sequel trilogy wrap up, but she wanted a second one, and I think it's very important. It's very nice that we did it, because again, my mind has been opened on numerous things that we're thinking about and diving deeper into. So, no, super fascinating.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that we were Jedi a little bit and took some time to reflect on this fear, to confront it, and then we can. I feel like we have closed this chapter and we can move on from our fear. We have processed our fear, looked at our fear, and we can continue on with our actions.
But were we Jedi or were we something different?
Oh!
Yeah, were we something that never got that full name? Like,
I'll be a Skywalker.
Skywalker. We both can be Skywalkers.
We'll be Skywalkers. Right, Solo?
We'll be Skywalkers. Our cats are closing out our season with us because, yeah, this is the end of season one.
Yeah, thank you for listening and taking this journey with us.
It's been a full year, listeners. So
that's crazy.
That's crazy. we will be taking a break. We are getting married in the month of January, so you may already be married by the time you listen to this. But we are going to take some time off, and we will be back with season two.
Yes. We need to do a little bit of research to prep for season two, but we will be back with that. I don't know, a couple months.
We'll see. It will be before the summer. I can put a deadline on. We will be before June.
I mean, part of me wants to say, certainly before that. Part of me wants to say before Celebration.
Oh, well, so we'll see. We'll see. We're
but
not sure.
But that's, Celebration is early April. So
that's early April. So we'll we may be back for May the 4th. We'll see.
Yeah, I like that goal.
That might be that might be our goal. So we'll be back for May the 4th, and
and
be back with anger.
Yes,
because we get to. So we don't have to do our pilot episode of explaining the emotions, but we will have an intro episode discussing what anger is and how we're going to look at it.
Yeah.
So there'll be a couple drops in that when we start off, because we'll start off with that and then jump right into the prequel trilogy.
Yes.
So
we'll watch anger through. The numerical order.
Yes. Again, always through numerical order for now.
Oh, well, I mean, we watched fear through release order.
Oh, did we? We did.
We did.
Do we want to keep going with that, or do we want to switch it up?
To me, if we switch it up, we're going between chronological and release, because it never makes sense to watch the sequel trilogy first, like backwards.
Correct. No, I agree. So do we want to do chronological or
I
release
for this watch through with anger? I'd be tempted to do chronological order. So okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9.
All right, then that's what we're gonna do, listeners. You just had our first conversation on the podcast, so welcome. You're all part of it, and we will be having that conversation. So we will be watching the Star Wars, the Skywalker Saga, through anger. And we will be starting from episode one.
The
Phantom Menace. It's going to be fascinating. Yeah. I'm going to be finding brand new ways to look at things, and it's going to be super fun. So remember, listeners.
Your focus determines your reality.
Your focus determines your reality.
If you want to find us on the socials, you can find us on Twitter, as it still stands, at Feeling Force Pod. That's at Feeling Force Pod. Or you can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Feeling the Force Pod. That's facebook.com/Feeling the Force Pod. Or you can send us an email. Send us an email at our email address, which we've gotten a couple of, which is feelingtheforcepod@gmail.com. That's feelingtheforcepod. That's feelingtheforcepod@gmail.com. We're also on the Hive Social. So if you want to catch us on Hive Social, you can always check us out there. So we are on Hive Social at Feeling the Force.
Right! Don't you call me a mindless philosopher.